Let's now move on to deep learning-based methods. And in particular, in this unit, we will be focusing on two-stage or so-called region-based convolutional neural networks that are amongst the most powerful deep learning-based techniques and the de facto standard nowadays for object detection. Classical approaches, as we have seen in the previous unit, haven't led to major breakthroughs in object recognition. Only for specific non-safety critical tasks such as face detection on a camera, they have seen great success, at least in terms of applications. Why is that? Well, the first and most difficult problem is that computer vision features are actually very difficult to hand engineer. They are really hard to design. We humans just don't know what a good feature should look like. It's unclear how a good representation should look like. Furthermore, sliding window approaches are typically quite slow in practice because they have to search through this vast space of all possible bounding boxes. And inference in complicated part-based graphical models doesn't improve the situation, but makes these methods even slower. The results that I've shown you in the previous unit's video required about 1 minute computation time per frame. And the reason for this is that computation is often not efficiently reduced, apart from that complicated inference in graphical models is sometimes needed. But deep learning luckily has changed this, and now recognition is a success story as well. So here's an overview slide that illustrates the progress, right? So the first thing that we could do is we could take the input image and pass the RGB pixels directly through a classifier. So we have this trainable block and we have directly the image as the representation. But this doesn't work very well, as we've seen. A better solution is to compute gradients and pass those through a classifier. Now we have some handcrafted features here in yellow and a trained component in green. And even better is to take the gradients and form histograms and pass this hand-engineered representation through a learned classifier. Or to do something on top of these histograms, something like k-means or sparse coding, or a popular representation that has been used is called flat. But all of these approaches suffer from the problem that these intermediate representations, these intermediate processing layers have been hand-engineered without any focus on optimality. And so the difference in deep learning now, of course, is that we try to learn all those features. Now all these boxes are trainable, green boxes here. And we learn all of these low-level features. These are the early layers in our deep neural network, and the mid-level features and the high-level features, which are the later layers, and even the classifier. It's all one big neural network that is trained end-to-end. And this really has led to dramatic improvements in performance. While the performance of object detection techniques has plateaued in from 2005 to around 2010, with the performance on this particular benchmark for the deformable part-based model that we've seen in the previous unit being around only 5 mean average precision. With the first deep learning-based models, such as FastRCNN, using a very simple backbone like AlexNet, we already got a 3 times improvement in average precision. And then within 2.5 years of development of deep neural network-based detection methods, we got another increase in factor 3. So there has been tremendous progress within a very short period of time. This unit here is based on slides from Ross Gershek, who is one of the main people behind this series of algorithms that I'm going to describe now on object detection with region-based deep neural networks. And so I want to credit Russ here for the slides. So let's start. How can we detect objects using deep neural networks? The naive idea is to classify all possible boxes in the image using a classification deep neural network. But of course, that's infeasible, as we've seen, as there's too many boxes. So we can't do that, even if the space is discretized. A better idea is to first detect a smaller set of candidate bounding boxes that might contain an object. Not all of them are correct, but some of them are. So we are effectively quantizing the space. And of course, we should choose this set of maybe 2,000 candidate bounding boxes to be overcomplete. We should rather include more boxes, but we should make sure that the set of boxes contains all the ground truth boxes. This is the first stage. And it's a two-stage detector because it also has a second stage where we take all of these 2,000 boxes, let's say, and classify them now with into a set of labels, different objects or background category, and also refine the location of the boxes using a deep neural network, because we have quantized we have reduced the number of candidate bounding boxes before. Now we need to have an opportunity, an ability to refine the location to make the output of the detector, the output bounding boxes, be more precise. So these are the two stages. And therefore this approach is called a proposal-based or two-stage object detector. Note that we have split the original object detection problem now into two proxy tasks. The task of detecting a smaller set of candidate bounding boxes, or the task of quantization of bounding box space, and the second task of classifying, refining this set of candidate bounding boxes. And it's also illustrated here again, we see that by approximation with a finite set of bounding boxes, we might get a quantization error that is illustrated here. So we have this picture here of this dinosaur, and we have this quantized box, which is okay, but it's not perfect. So we have this quantization error with respect to the true box. And what we want to do now in this second stage that I have described here is to refine the location of the boxes to predict this delta from this green proposal box to the final prediction here in dashed green, in order to recover the loss of localization accuracy by regressing the location offset in the second stage. And of course, also we remove redundant predictions using non-maximum suppression clustering, as we did also in the sliding window-based for the sliding window-based techniques, because here there might be multiple proposal boxes that regress to the same object, and so we want to keep only the most confident one, only a single prediction per ground truth. Now let's look into the details of the first deep learning method for object detection that's called RCNN and is described in this paper, Rich Feature Hierarchies for Accurate Object Detection and Semantic Segmentation. RCNN stands for Region-Based Convolutional Neural Network, because the idea is very simple. We are computing these proposals, these regions, and then for each of these regions, we apply a convolutional neural network classifier. So we use an off-the-shelf region detector proposal algorithm first, and at the time there were a number of algorithms available, such as selective search or edge boxes. These are very simple generic algorithms that don't take into account the category of the object. So it could be a horse or rider or a bicyclist or anything, but they are trained for detecting generic objects. And they're doing this okay, but they are generating typically very imprecise predictions. So we need to sample much more boxes. We need to apply a low threshold on the confidence in order to get a large number of boxes that we can later then classify. So we run one of these classical techniques here to get a set of boxes, and then we crop and warp the original image into a fixed representation and forward propagate this fixed size representation into a through a convolutional neural network, a standard convolutional neural network, to get a feature representation. And then we have two output heads, one that classifies that region. For example, it classifies this as a horse rider, and one that regresses the offset of the bounding box corners to refine them to fit the ground truth better than the original proposals that are quite coarse and noisy and imprecise. And what you can see here also is that this yellow region here is indicating the components that require only a per image computation. So we do this computation only once. Only once we compute the boxes for that image. But this area here in green indicates the components that require per region computation. So per region we need to crop and warp, and per region we need to run a confnet. And here you can already see why this is slow, because we need to run a full-fledged convolutional network for each of these 2,000 proposals that are proposed by the selective search algorithm, for example. We can now generalize this representation, this framework here, into more general form, and we'll see that this is useful to understand the innovations on top of the original RCNN algorithm that we've just seen. So we look at this, these two regions with per image computation and per region computation. And in this generalized framework, we have a transformation of the input image here into a featureized representation first. And then we have a mechanism for object region proposal detection that are computed from that image. We call this R of I. So we have the features F of I. This is the feature map. And here we have the regions that are computed from that image, R of I. And then we have a function that takes the features and the regions and computes a featureized representation of each of these proposal regions. And then we apply additional processing to each proposed feature, and we have multiple heads to make task-specific predictions. Now, if we look at the RCNN, this first, most simple version of deep learning-based two-stage object detection, in this framework, this is what it would look like. The feature mapping here is simply the identity function, so it copies the image as the feature representation. And for this function here that computes the regions from that image, we simply use one out-of-the-box, classical, traditional, non-deep learning-based algorithms like selective search. And then this combination function is simply a cropping and warping operation. And then this per-region computation is a full-fledged convolutional network. And then we have two heads, one for the classification and one for the bounding box refinement, the regression task. Now, what is the problem with RCNN? Well, the first problem is that we have heavy per region computation. We need to do 2,000 full network evaluations, right? For each of these proposals, we need to run a full AlexNet or ResNet architecture to make a prediction. So it's quite slow. And also we don't utilize computation or feature sharing, because we're doing this really independently. We really independently run 2,000 inference processes, 2,000 inputs through this network. Another disadvantage is that we have a slow region proposal method that adds to the runtime. So these here are really classical techniques that don't use deep learning. They run on the CPU, they are quite slow. So this is not ideal if we are targeting like frame rate, real-time object detection. And then we have generic region proposal techniques, so these classical techniques, which have quite limited recall. Despite choosing a low threshold, they are still not predicting all of the, like a box for all of the ground truth objects. So the next version of this two-stage object detection family is called fast RCNN, fast region convolutional neural network. And what it does, it has a lighter weight per region computation. It's effectively an end-to-end trainable version of SSPNet, and it's illustrated here. In the first step here, what we now do differently is we don't just copy the image as a feature representation, but we run the fully convolutional network backbone in order to produce features from that image. But we do this only once per image. So we are sharing computation here. We map this input image to a lower resolution spatial feature map. In a second step, we apply region of interest pooling, which converts each of these regions here into a fixed dimensional representation. And then, because we have done a lot of this processing already in the per image part here, we only require a lightweight multi-layer perceptron to process each of these region feature maps. And then we have a classification head and a box regression head as before. The main difference to before is now that a lot of the computation has been moved from the per region area in green to the per image area in yellow. And this makes the processing much faster. That's why it's called fast RCNN. So let's look at these individual blocks in a little bit more detail. First at this FCN block here. This is a standard convolutional network that we use here as a backbone. So it could be an AlexNet, a VGG, a ResNet, Inception, DenseNet. Actually, the stronger the recognition backbone, the better. Features really matter. That's also a conclusion from all of these papers. The stronger your backbone, the stronger your object detection results, no matter what you do on top. One thing that has been removed from these backbones is the final global pooling layer, which reduces the spatial dimensions to one, because in these original architectures, we were interested in the per image classification problem, but now we want to create a feature map that has a spatial extent. So we are creating an output that has spatial dimensions proportional to the input spatial dimensions. For example, if we have an input image of size width times height, then the output feature map might have 512 channels, and we might have a feature map of width W over 16 and H over 16. So we're reducing by a factor of 16 in each dimension, but we're still keeping some spatial resolution. The second block, the second innovation of fast RCNN is this ROI pooling operation here. And the idea is now, of course, to extract features from this feature map based on these regions that have been detected by the proposal mechanism. And this is one of the key innovations of this earlier work called SSPNet. So the idea is rather simple. So we have a proposal region here from this proposal detector, and we have also the feature map that's indicated in blue here in the background. But of course, this proposal region might not be perfectly aligned with the spatial grid, this low resolution feature map. And so what we do is we snap the ROE to the closest aligned, grid aligned feature, sub-feature map. We transform an arbitrarily sized proposal into this fixed dimensional representation, in other words. And then we apply max pooling here. We compute the feature value as the max over the input cells in order to obtain a fixed size representation, in this case a 2x2 feature map from this, in this case, 4x3 region here. So this is all that's done in the ROI pooling. We're snapping the proposal region to the grid of the feature map, and then we are pooling to a fixed 2x2 spatial resolution, and that is then fed as input to this lightweight MLP. And so the advantage now is, of course, that we don't have any heavy per region computation anymore. We don't require 2,000 full network evaluations anymore, but we have offloaded this to the backbone, and we just require this lightweight MLP evaluations per region. So we're effectively making use of feature sharing and computation sharing. But we still have this slow region proposal method that adds to the runtime, and we have a generic region proposal technique that has low recall still built into this model. So the next variant, the next evolution of this family of two-stage detectors is called faster RCNN. Note that this has happened all in a very short period of time. You can realize that also all of these extensions are quite simple. So this has all happened within 1 year or so. I remember when Russ gave this talk at a conference, and at the conference, he presented already the next version, the next innovation of the paper, rather than what was actually published at the conference. Yeah, so research is fast today. Okay, so what is faster RCN doing differently? Well, what it's doing differently is it's not using this generic region proposal mechanism, these classical methods, but it uses a learned proposal. It uses learned proposals by computing the proposals through a network that shares computation with the whole image network. So instead of this arrow here, we have this arrow that goes from this feature map, from the features of the backbone. It directly regresses the proposals as well and trains the entire model jointly end to end. How does this region proposal network look like? This is this part here. The way that it's implemented in faster RCNN is a simple 3x3 kernel that's swept over this convolutional feature map. This is this feature map here. This is the output of the backbone, which scans the feature map looking for interesting objects, generic objects. And it defines an anchor box. And the predictions are with respect to this box, not the 3x3 sliding window. And the reason why this anchor box is chosen larger than the 3x3 sliding window is that, of course, the features that are stored in this 3x3 sliding window have a much larger receptive field, so they see more. And looking at just this little red region, we still have information from this area here, for instance, because we have a this convolutional backbone that has this, that extends the receptive field, as common in convolutional networks. So we are, based on these features, predicting a bounding box relative to this anchor box. And for this region proposal network, again, we have an objectness classifier. So it's not an object class classifier, but just an objectness classifier. We just want to classify, is there something independent of its class, or is it background? And then we have a box regressor that predicts the offset to the anchor box. So for example, in this case, the objectness classifier might result in a high score because we are located at this, like centrally at this dinosaur. And the box regressor predicts the offset of the anchor box to fit this object more precisely. And here's another example where the objectness score would be lower because we are not centered at the object. In practice, the authors of faster RCN use multiple anchor boxes to accommodate multiple aspect ratios of objects. So here we can see three different anchor boxes, one that is quadratic and two that are rectangular, in order as a basis for the offset predictions. So we're doing this. We have basically in this process here, let me go back. We have K classification problems and K box regression problems per region. So we have K objectness classifiers and K box regressors. Another innovation that turned out to be quite impactful, now like this faster RCNN basically has removed the problem of slow region proposal methods that add to the runtime and these generic techniques that have low recall. So it is not limited in its recall, and also runtime has increased dramatically. So we have really a method that runs at 10 frames per second or so now. But one additional trick that has improved performance on top of this is the idea of a feature pyramid network. The idea here is that the whole image feature representation here can be improved by making it multi-scale. What does that mean? The goal of feature pyramid networks is to improve scale equivariance. Remember that a detector needs to classify and localize objects over a wide range of scales. For example, this cat here might occur in the vicinity of the camera, but it might also occur very far apart. And so we want to detect this cat independent of its size. And the feature pyramid network improves this ability. So what can we do in order to detect objects at different scales, at different sizes? Well, the most simple idea that we have already talked about in the last unit is to use a image pyramid to downscale the image, different resolutions, and then run exactly the same object detection algorithm at these different resolutions. So we compute the features, and then we do predictions. But of course, this is slow because for each image pyramid level, for each of these resolutions, we need to run the entire faster RCNN algorithm. So this is not ideal. A second strategy is to simply use the multi-scale features like in fast or faster RCNN and leave it all to the features. Now, this is of course much faster because we just have to run a single network and we take these features at the coarsest resolution at the final layer of this backbone and use that for making predictions. But this is suboptimal because we can't detect objects at all scales equally well. The third strategy that we could use is a naive in-network pyramid, where we use the internal pyramid and apply or make predictions at every individual feature scale. Now, this is also fast, but it's still suboptimal. And so the idea and the reason for this is that the first pyramid level, there has relatively little processing happened until that. So we have only high resolution and weak features, right? And only strong features at the lower levels where more convolutional layers have been processed. So for the smaller objects, we would have to detect them with just very few layers, and for the objects that are large, we would detect them with many layers, so we can detect those better. So we have strong features at low resolution and weak features at high resolution. And so the idea now to improve this is a simple unit, basically, and that's called a feature pyramid network here, where we have a top-down enrichment of high-resolution features, which is still fast, but less suboptimal. And so the idea is really just a unit where we have an encoder and skip connections, and then we have a decoder. And so in this case, we have strong features both at the high resolution and at the low resolution, because both at the high and the low resolution, we are receiving information from all scales, all feature scales of this network. And then we can use those to make predictions. What do the results of such a object detector look like? So here's an example applied to the one of the Kitty sequences, and you can see, well, it's flickering a little bit because there's no temporal continuity, but you can see that cars are most often correctly detected, but there's also some other objects that are incorrectly classified as cars in this case. One nice thing that we've already seen in this video just now is that we can also generalize this framework very easily to other output modalities. It's easy to add more output heads to this framework. For example, Masgar CNN from 2017 adds an instance segmentation mask per detection, and a dense pose predicts object coordinates, which are in this case relative 3D locations on human bodies. If you have a data set where this is annotated, you can also predict it. And mesh RCNN predicts triangular meshes per object. So let me just show you, this was an amazing result at the time, the result of dense pose, where in parallel, in real time, these object coordinates are predicted and then can be converted into human body pose estimates. And this is illustrated here. So you can see many objects moving in parallel and the predictions of this method here. The nice thing also about our community is that nearly all of these state-of-the-art methods are freely available. You can download them, and there's good software frameworks available. For example, Facebook Research has released Detectron and Detectron 2, which implements all of these techniques and also the different output modalities, as you can see here. So I encourage you, if you're curious, to try it out yourself. Finally, one problem I want to also highlight is the foreground-background imbalance that occurs when training object detection algorithms. The problem is that the number of positive and negative boxes is heavily imbalanced. In fact, there's only a few objects typically in an image, but there is much more negative boxes that we could sample from the background that contain not the object of interest. So before quantization, when we consider continuous bounding box coordinates, there's an infinite imbalance. But even after quantization, after selecting a subset of discrete boxes, we still have only 0.01 to 0.1% foreground boxes compared to all the boxes. In other words, we have 99.9% background boxes. And learning a classifier from such imbalanced data is very difficult, because the classifier, if you've ever trained such a classifier, will realize that the classifier will simply ignore the minority class, because it will obtain nearly 100% accuracy by predicting everything as background. Now, how can this problem be improved? Well, one solution is to use a loss function which pays attention to hard examples. And one prominent example here is the so-called focal loss that has led to considerable performance improvements in object detection, where you can see here in blue the curve for the cross entropy loss, which still assigns significant penalty to well-classified examples. And then this modified version, it's a very simple modification of this loss function that nudges this curve further down. So for example, for a value of gamma equals 5, we have this green curve here, such that the well-classified examples receive less penalty and the focus is more on the less well-classified examples. Another solution that we've already seen now quite extensively is the idea of a cascade. So the idea of a proposal-based detector, where we first select a set of proposals, and then in the second stage, the classifier sees more balanced data, of course, also helps. And this can be combined with the idea of focal loss. And then finally, we can perform more extreme forms of quantization, which is what single-stage detectors do. They reduce the imbalance simply by construction. And I want to briefly highlight this type of detectors as well, because they are really fast. They are much, much faster than, for example, the faster RCNN detector, which already is much faster than the classical models from the 2000s. So the idea of a single-stage detector is to predict the object boxes in a single forward pass. And examples of such single-stage detectors are YOLO and SSD. And the idea here really is, given the input image, to predict at a very coarse resolution, in this case 7x7 only, the class probability and to regress the bounding boxes for each of these cells here, from each of these cells here in parallel, plus a confidence score that directly leads to the final detections. Now, through this extreme quantization, we can do the entire processing in a single stage, and it's extremely fast, but in general, the performance is worse due to this dramatic subsampling of the output space. And the large quantization error is hard to correct in practice, which leads to a lower AP metric, typically, than the two-stage detectors that we've seen before. And then finally, more recently, there has been a trend to alternative paradigms to object detection. And one prominent example is called DETER, which uses a transformer encoder and a transformer decoder. So it's a very different way of using deep neural networks. It's inspired by language models that use a lot of transformers these days, where the input image is passed through a backbone and then tokenized. And the transformer produces a set of features for these tokens. And then these features are input to a decoder. And then we learn jointly not only these features, but also a set of object queries that are then decoded into the individual predictions.